Good evening, folks. Welcome. Welcome, folks. Lovely to see you here. Thank you for joining. Good evening to everyone who's joining us. We'll just give it a few seconds to allow people to come in. Good evening, everyone. Thanks for joining us. We've got people still coming in, so I'll just give it a few more seconds. Hi, Helena, nice to see you. Hi to everyone coming in. Okay, I think we'll make a start now. Well, good evening, everybody, and a very warm welcome to the online Naturetrek Roadshow. For those of you who haven't joined a presentation evening with me yet, I'm Sarah Frost, Naturetrek's marketing manager, and I've worked for Naturetrek for 6 years now. Despite the title of marketing manager, I'm trained as a zoologist and I'm a leader of our wildlife cruisers, and I'll be your host for this evening, speaking to you from Hampshire. We've continued to have some glorious sunny weather here over the last few days, and I hope you have too, wherever you are, and you've been able to get out into your local countryside, and it's getting more spring-like by the day here. Last week we fitted a new barn owl box in our 12-acre field at our office, and we're very much hoping that the barn quartering the field regularly actually takes up residence in that this year. And last week was another very busy week at the Naturetrek office as we hosted our very first ever live virtual tour. Now, never in our wildest dreams of running wildlife holidays would we have imagined running a tour virtually, continuing to try to come up with ways to keep you all entertained at home, as well as give our guides an opportunity to get back to doing what they do best. So on Friday, in for an hour to watch our guide Manuel in Ecuador do some virtual bird watching for us from a feeding station in Mindo, with our viewers being able to telescope views of hummingbirds and tanagers flitting about. And we were even treated to a toucan barbet and two plate-billed mountain toucans, which came over to the feeders. And that was really special and the highlight for most viewers. I know many of you who've tuned into that session will be listening this evening, and I hope that you all enjoy. Many positive messages in my inbox over the last few days saying how wonderful it was and that it was the best use of Zoom since the beginning of the pandemic. So that's quite the compliment, and we're thrilled. Well, please do join us for our next one. We'll be coming to you live from Spain at 12 noon this Thursday. I'll pop the link into the chat on this webinar in a moment for anyone who's signed up. Now, we have almost 400 households joining us this evening, so we could guesstimate around 600 people, and a very warm welcome to all. Good morning, indeed, if you're joining us from a different time zone. We do continue to have people joining us from overseas. I know a couple of our speakers have put out tweets to invite those who are interested in botany and butterflies to join this presentation evening. So a particularly warm welcome to you if this is your first Naturetrek event. As usual, come to use the chat section, which is at the bottom of the screen on a PC or at the top of a screen on an iPad. You have the option here to send messages to just those panelists, to all attendees. Do go ahead and include all attendees if you'd like to. If you're sending a message that you think would be useful for others to hear, perhaps if you're giving a recommendation, such. For those of you who are on smaller screens, such as iPads, if you find any of the chat messages distracting, you can just mute them by tapping the little bell icon. Furthermore, please do ask any questions that you may have using the Q&A section, be it specific questions about the species or the tour, or even broader questions about the travel industry as a whole. We're very happy to answer those. We'll answer them throughout the evening as we can, but we'll spend most time answering them at 9:05 after the last presentation. If you don't have a copy of our brochure and would like one, then now is the time to get one, as we've been receiving plenty of bookings for forward travel later this year and into next year. The government's announcement a couple of weeks ago. You can email us at info@naturetrek.co.uk to request one, and we'll be delighted to pop one in the post to you. Like, site is a huge resource of information, and it has further details of all of our tours, including detailed itineraries, and it's teeming with tour reports of previous. So please do go online and have an explore. Finally, for any people who are new to Zoom, don't worry, we can't see or hear you. It's only the panelists that are in the spotlight. So pour yourself a glass of wine and enjoy the evening. Now, tonight, we're back to the joys of botany and butterflies for the second of our two dedicated evenings. We'll be talking to you about the Canary Islands, Bulgaria, France, and Kazakhstan. This evening, we'll be hearing talks from tour leaders Jessica Turner, Andrew Cleave, David Palms, and I'm also joined by Naturetrek General Manager Andy Tucker, who's here to help answer any questions. So, without any further ado, I'll hand you over. Who's going to take us to the Canary Islands? Jessica, over to you.
Hello. Is everyone able to see that?
No, we can't see that yet, Jessica. You need to, have you clicked the share screen button, the green button?
I did do. I will come out and go back again, sorry.
That's it, it's starting to load now.
There we go.
Brilliant, yeah. And then if you just make the PowerPoint full screen, brilliant, fantastic.
Apologies for that. Anyway, I'm Jessica and I've been leading for Naturetrek since 2007, but I was a client before that from the year 2000. And I'm talking to you from near Oxford. And I'm primarily a botanist, but I do enjoy all aspects of natural history. And although this evening's billed as a botany and butterflies evening, the Canary Islands are an all-round destination that's got something for everybody in them. So there are seven main islands. We've got La Palma over on the left, Tenerife and Gomera, Gran Canaria, Fuerteventura, and Lanzarote over there on the right, and El Hierro down there. And Naturetrek visit five of these islands. They're called the Canaries because the Romans named them after the dogs that were found there. But in fact, they may have been referring to monk seals, which were known as sea wolves. All the islands are volcanic, and Fuerteventura and Lanzarote are the oldest islands and the most eroded, and they're the ones closest to Africa, about 100 kilometres away. And La Palma is the youngest, with a volcano that erupted in the early 70s. And there are large numbers of endemic species on the Canary Islands. There's about 25% of the plants are endemic just to the Canaries. Another 20% to Madeira and the Canaries. And when you're talking about beetles and so on, it's up to about 70%. So there's loads of endemic species. So we'll start with La Palma, and we go twice to La Palma in the spring, in February or March, and then also in September as well. And we fly into the airport and stay at the hotel here, just south of the airport, just south of Santa Cruz. And for the boat trips, for the whale and dolphin trip, there's usually four boat trips. In the spring, it's either two or three. We go out from Tazacorte over here on the west. And all the waters around the Canary Islands are exceptionally good for cetaceans. But we also have time to explore the rest of the island. And up here in the northeast is the main laurel forest area, with some of the best laurel forest, very good for pigeons, the endemic pigeons. All the islands are visited by the trade winds, which are northeasterly winds. So the north and east of the islands are the lushest and greenest, and La Palma's the lushest island. And then down in the south and the west, it's more dry and desert-like. So from our hotel, there are no golden sandy beaches here, but it's absolutely on the sea. You can do sea watching from balconies often. And it's just south, there's Santa Cruz, the capital, up there. So Cory's Shearwater is something that we usually get some lovely views of, especially when we're out at sea, but you can also record good numbers often from balconies. And among the cetaceans, Atlantic spotted dolphin is a good species, rough-toothed dolphin, bottlenose dolphin, Brutus whale, pilot whales, all sorts of species, loggerhead turtles as well. So a lot out at sea, but not many plants or butterflies. As I say, in the laurel forest, laurel species are very characteristic of the area. It's relic of a type of forest that was more widespread around the Mediterranean. And you get the endemic pigeons, the laurel pigeon, and this one, the Bowles pigeon, that's taken on La Palma, where you get some of the best views. Plants, here's Canary Island bellflower, which occurs on all the Western islands. And this one's being visited by a La Palma brimstone, which is a subspecies of canary brimstone. So sometimes known as a canary Cleopatra. There are endemic species to the different islands, different subspecies rather. And this is a chain fern underneath. There are a large number of endemic plants, and especially echiums are particularly well represented on the islands. This one's Echium webbii that's endemic to La Palma. And I'll be showing you one or two images of different echiums, borage family on other islands. Other butterflies, the canary large white, which you get on La Palma and Tenerife, is easier to see on La Palma. So all sorts of things on La Palma. It was a new trip, and the spring one, and we managed half a week before we got locked down, but we packed an awful lot into that half week, and looking forward to running the full spring trip very soon. Going to Gran Canaria, we land down at the airport on the east side, and our hotel is up here on the northwest. And we run these trips as go slow and a very similar one, but it's labelled at Christmas rather than go slow Gran Canaria at Christmas, which gets a bit of a mouthful. Because of the size of the island, there's a bit more travelling by minibus than in some of the go slow trips, but we take a leisurely pace and have plenty of time to explore laurel forests, the centre of the island, boat trips from down here in the southwest, sand dunes here. Again, it's very much a trip with something for everybody. Our hotel at Agaiety has fantastic sea views. And as you saw in the last one, nice pools as well. And the coast up in the northwest is very dramatic. Well worth exploring, and has its own endemic species just to that area. And that's a contrast to the sand dunes down at Maspalomas, which are near the more touristy areas, but again, a fascinating habitat. The botanic gardens just outside the capital are in a very lush ravine with lots of endemic plants, all the canary endemics nearly planted up in the gardens, and lots of endemic species around. And it's very good for the Gran Canaria giant lizard, which can be up to a meter in length. This one was about half a meter in length, but they like living in the rocky ravine around the botanic gardens. It's also good for monarch butterflies, which you find in the lusher areas all year round. So you find them in the winter as well as in the summer. Canary red admirals, another one for all year round as well. And canaries, which are called after the island rather than the islands being called after the bird, feature in Tenerife, in Gran Canaria, La Palma. Always good to see. And there's one of the Gran Canaria endemic echiums, Echium onosmifolium, one of the white-flowered echiums. Another genus that has lots of endemic representatives in the different islands are the cinerarias, Pericalis. This is Pericalis webbii. You may have noticed that the echium on La Palma was webbii, and Philip Barker Webb wrote a 9-volume natural history of the Canary Islands in the 1830s, along with the Frenchman Berthelot, who gave his name to the pipit, which is endemic here. And carline thistle, you find that on 2 or 3 of the islands, the willow leaf carline thistle. So on some days in Gran Canaria, we visit picnic sites, have picnics. Other days we have tapas lunches, but with the famous Naturetrek picnics and the advantage of this spot among the Canary pines at the top of the island, here's our local guide, Guelmo, leading us in looking for one of the rarest passerines, which very fortunately likes this area, which is the Gran Canaria blue chaffinch. It's recently been split from the Tenerife blue chaffinch, of which more later, but the Gran Canaria one is harder to see and always a great joy. Another day, as opposed to having a tapas lunch, we have lunch at a finca which grows its own coffee, and we sample their own homegrown coffee and homegrown wine and tropical fruit and so on. So as I say, something for everybody on this trip. Another evening we go up to the top of the island to watch the sunset, and there's Mount Teide on Tenerife, and we have dinner in a hotel up there before coming back down to our hotel in the dark. So over to Tenerife then, and it's just called the Canary Islands, this one, because it includes the 3 islands, Tenerife, La Gomera and Fuerteventura. And we fly into the airport here down in the south, and we stay at Villaflor, which is on the southern hill slopes on the edge of the volcano Mount Teide, the highest point, which is at 3,700 meters. That was the mountain in the very, very first slide. And from here, we go all over the island, the Taino Peninsula up here in the northwest and the Anaga Peninsula up here in the northeast. And as you might expect, the laurel forest is mainly up here. And again, lots of endemic species, lots of things to see. Our hotel is a spa hotel set amidst Canary Island pines. Beautiful location, and birds around about. You get the Canary Island chiffchaff, you get canaries, and you can find the Tenerife blue chaffinch in the garden, which is also a joy. The Taino Peninsula up in the northwest looks quite desert-like, but these things that look like cacti are actually part of another genus that's very well represented on the islands, and that's a spurge, euphorbia. So this is Euphorbia canariense, the Canary Island cactus spurge. And there are also bushes of other spurges here, Euphorbia balsamifera, the sweet spurge. Good place to look up here for Barbary falcons. And also on one occasion, we had really good views. This little lad, Barbary partridge, crossed the road and discovered that he'd walked into a cliff. So we took quick photos before encouraging him to walk back the other way and down the cliffside. We often have good views of those on La Gomera. Every island has its own endemic lizards species or subspecies. And this is the West Canaries lizard and the North Tenerife subspecies. The subspecies on La Palma has a really much bluer throat. And then there's a different subspecies in South Tenerife and another one on the Anaga Peninsula or on an island off the Anaga Peninsula. In the middle, you've got Mount Teide, which is always very dramatic for its lava flows. It's not an active volcano, but seeing the different larval forms and the geology. We're a bit early to see it in its colourful glory because you need to be there sort of May through to July to see all the plants in full flower in general. This is Mount Teide broom here. And another special species, which we don't see in flower, unfortunately, is yet another echium. This one is the Mount Tede Bugloss, Echium will pretii, and you can see just how tall they can get. And these have wonderful red flowers. In the autumn, we occasionally find little patches of one still in flower, but you need to be there in high summer to see the whole thing in flower. They also call them a tower of jewels, and you can see why. One plant we do see in the autumn is the Canary Islands or Canary Sea Daffodil, Pancratium canariense. And there are one or two other species that we see more of in the autumn than in the spring. But in general, spring is more floriferous. And sow thistles are very well represented. And if you think of sow thistle as being about dandelion size in your garden, well, here, this one is a tree, or at least a large shrub. This is the canary sow thistle, Sonchus canariensis. Another plant is the Canary Island foxglove, Isoplexis canariensis. If in doubt, it's canary something or something canariensis. One day we take the minibus or buses over to La Gomera for the day, and we go over on the ferry, which is a good chance for some sea watching, shearwaters, pilot whales, that sort of thing. And the park at San Sebastian is usually very good for African grass blues and monarch butterflies among the trees. And then we go up into the center of the island, which is laurel forest, and is a lovely area of laurel forest, very unspoiled. And stopping on the way, we'll stop to look at some more euphorbias. This one's Euphorbia lamarckii, which does grow on other islands as well, but I highlighted this because we found the caterpillar of the Barbary spurge hawk moth, endemic to the islands. And in fact, we saw an adult on La Palma, which is a different subspecies from this one from La Gomera. The laurel forest in the center, laurel forest is often known as the Atlantic rainforest or cloud forest, because it does tend to get the cloud, and it's why there's so many mosses and ferns and so on, very lush, lots of lichens and other plants among the laurel trees. And then in drier areas on all the islands, you get lots of succulents. This is a Greenovia, Greenovia aurea, and there are lots of Ioniums as well. And then on day five, we fly off to Fuerteventura, a short flight, and the airport's up here. And we stay down by Costa Calma because it's the best area for the desert area around here. The hotel's a big tourist hotel. They look up after us very well. Not the most beautiful, but it does have species like the Canarian subspecies of great grey shrike in the grounds. And we go out into the desert at dawn and often in the evening as well, looking for species. I don't know if you can see them there. We've actually got some cream-coloured coursers. There's a close-up of one. And the star species here that we're looking for is Hubara bustard. And we also look for spectacled warbler, Canary Island stonechat, the canary subspecies of raven, and other species as well. One of the butterflies that's special in Fuerteventura, but in desert areas elsewhere, is the greenish black tip, like an orange tip, but with different colours. And among the special plants that we look for, there's this bindweed, convolvulus. It's called convolvulus caput medusa, Medusa's head, because it looks like Medusa having a bad hair day. And another plant we look for is Caralluma burchardii, which we usually see in flower in the autumn and in seed in the spring, with these amazingly hairy flowers. And Fuerteventura also has one of the rarest spurges, one that only grows on the Handia Peninsula right down in the south of the island. So all sorts of interesting things. One of the iconic species is the dragon tree, so called because it has red sap that looks like blood. It's actually in the asparagus family, and it only flowers once every 10 to 15 years. And after it flowers, it branches. So you can actually age a tree by seeing how often it's branched. This is probably somewhere around 90 to 100 years old, this tree. So thank you very much indeed. Very much a taster, but I hope it's whetted your appetite to find out more. Thank you.
Jessica. And Andrew, now over to you.
Hey, thank you. One moment, I'll just get my screen printed out. Okay, how's that?
Yep, that's fine, Andrew.
Well, off to Bulgaria. In fact, there are several tours to Bulgaria, and the one that we're going to look at tonight is called Flowers of the Balkans. But there are tours for birding, dragonflies, butterflies, but this is a midsummer trip. And the Balkans, well, that covers a large area, but Bulgaria, being right in the centre of it, seems to have more than its fair share of endemic plants and, as you see, beautiful scenery. And if one plant comes to mind, and I think about spending a week or so in midsummer in Bulgaria, it would be, well, this particular species of verbascum, a mullein. But in fact, it seems to be the epicenter in Europe for mulleins. There are many, many species, many of them called Balkan endemics. And some of them find their way here to Britain as garden plants. But here, mile after mile along the roads, any little bit of open countryside, even building plots in the middle of a town or a city, you'll have these fantastic verbascum species. And then once you start looking, of course, lots of other nice things. So to put you in the picture, where Bulgaria is, you can see that has the sea, the Black Sea, on the east coast, but then it's surrounded by many other countries. It's a sort of a crossing over place. So starting up in the north, we have Romania, and then we come round to the west with Serbia, Kosovo, Macedonia, Greece, and then Turkey. So there are many trade routes through Bulgaria, and the many natural routes, rivers and so on, which explains why the Botany is so interesting. And for the Flowers of the Balkans trip, we fly here into Sofia, and usually the flights, British Airways flights, are very convenient. And so we have time when we get there to visit a mountain, part of a national park, very close to the city. In the winter, it's obviously an important skiing area, but there are some good roads. And so we have a little breath of mountain air and start to see some really interesting plants as soon as we've got there, and then head off to our accommodation. We'll see in a moment. Then for the rest of the trip, we stay here in the west of the country. There are the Rila Mountains down here, very high, very dramatic mountains. And then we stop at a ski resort here, Bansko, an old town. And then finally, we head over here, right onto the border with Greece, and to the Rhodope Mountains, where there are yet more endemic special plants. At first you think, well, it looks a bit like anywhere else. You start recognizing plants as you're driving along until you realize you can't read the road signs. And don't make the mistake I did to say, oh, this looks like Russian. Our people look aghast if you should say such a thing, because Russian looks like Bulgarian. The Cyrillic script was devised many, many centuries ago by an Orthodox Church bishop, and that stuck, and it's slightly modified in Russia. So we're going to Studena, the Studena Lodge, and pottering along a roadside. Even if you never visited a national park or any of the mountain areas, there's so much to see of roadsides, lanes, of vacant plots. And some things are familiar, and then when you look closely, of course, they're strangely different. And so there are several species of foxglove. And this one is a fairly common roadside plant. There's some others we'll see a little bit later on. And butterflies that once were found in Britain, but now extinct in Britain, and here they're super abundant. This is after a rain shower, when there are just countless numbers of black-veined white butterflies just sheltering under leaves, waiting to dry off a little bit. Well, we stay here to start with, the Studena Lodge, and if we go back before the fall of the Iron Curtain back into the communist era. This was a hunting lodge. And so the rulers of the country would go and stay here for the weekend. Every room is fitted out with a gun rack. No guns in them now. It's in a lovely location surrounded by woodlands. And from there, we can do very good walks and just short drives to some other close by areas. First time I ever went there, when we walked into the grand dining room, there was this wonderful smell. And the people who are running the place, knowing that there's a party of botanists coming to stay, very kindly picked a great bunch of fragrant orchids for us and all sorts of other nice things. When we got over our horror at that, we had to thank them very much for how lovely they were. We had this fabulous scent every time we went in for breakfast or for an evening meal. It's a very good base, very quiet. And I'm sorry, back to the black-veined white butterflies again. It's just extraordinary, the Philadelphia shrub there, completely covered, fluttering with these butterflies. So we always see them, and midsummer is a very good time to have these on the wing. And of course, there are numerous insects there. If you rush around with a sweep net, you'll find all manner of shield bugs and capsid bugs, beetles, thing visiting flowers. Look at the lights outside the hotel on those white walls, first thing in the morning, and there'll be moths galore. So don't really need to go all that far, but we do, of course, we go out on forays into various national parks and important areas. And this is one close by. Limestone is actually slightly unusual here in this region, but the Golobardo Mountain, the name meaning that it's bare of trees, is a good spot. And it's bare of trees, I suppose, because of the grazing, but I'm told that the grazing is reducing, and you can see that it is beginning to get covered with scrub in places, which could be a problem. And just all sorts of exciting things that you recognize, you know, well, this is a type of kidney vetch, an anthyllis, and then you realize, of course, it's a different subspecies. And so many of the things we look at are described as a Balkan endemic or a Bulgarian endemic. And this one, this subspecies, covers the hillside. And this one, a very rare type of, a sort of knapweed, hardhead relative, very local indeed. A lot of these things, of course, have unpronounceable names, but Manuelis Loea, they're often named after long forgotten rulers of the country. But this limited to just two patches on this Golobardo Mountain area. We normally have a Bulgarian botanist guide, in fact, Vladimir Vladimirov, Vlados he's called, excellent. And he will always point out something rather as a Balkan endemic. And my answer is to sometimes say, find something else. Ah, well, an extremely rare British native. That's a good thing about going here, that there are lots of plants which are incredibly rare in Britain, suddenly become common here. Maybe not all of these things. Some of them we're familiar with as garden plants, but wonderful roadside plants, this beautiful showy rose. But also there are lots of things that are worth getting down on your hands and knees for. Have a closer look. This is a relative of the plant we have in Britain on chalk downlands, a bastard toad flax, as it's called, but this is a Balkan one. And larkspur, very rare plant in Britain, and probably only appears as a sort of bird seed alien, as an escape plant. But larkspur has these wonderful blue flowers, and that long, long spur gives it its name. An endemic, of course, a type of golden drop, so Nosmatarica. There are two, in fact, time to put them all in, but two endemic Onosmas on this same hillside. We end up with a really long plant list. I just had a look today at the last plant list I did. Well, not last year, of course, we couldn't go. The year before, and just about 900 species seen in the course of a week. So here's this lovely hillside again, this limestone, the bare of trees mountain, with this lovely golden kidney vetch on it. And butterflies can be excellent there. We sometimes get summer thunderstorms. All of a sudden, the sky will go black, it'll pour with rain, then clear up, and everything steams in the sun. And that's a good time to go out and look for the butterflies, and you'll probably end up with a lot of really new species for you, like this pearly heath. And in fact, tucked away there, not showing itself very well, a different one, this blue spot hair streak. So there are familiar species, of course, painted ladies, very common there, sometimes coming through in great waves. And lots of other things, of course, other invertebrates, monstrous snails, or Roman snails there, and quite a number of species, that are very rare in Britain. So we're out on one of these hillsides again, typical nature trek scene, botanists spread out over the hillside, limestone quarry in the background. And usually if we time it right, we can get to see this lizard orchid, but not the lizard orchid that we have in Britain. This one is an endemic species to this area, just coming out. But what is exciting for us is to find this as a relatively common roadside plant, red helleborine. About three sites for this in Britain, very shy flower in this country. In Hampshire, not far from where I am now, there's one site where it rarely flowers. So it's great just to wander along a roadside and see that. But back to the lizard orchids again, sometimes in a sunny patch, they're much more widely open. And then we have these wonderful streaming lower lips on the flowers. Well, roadsides and lanes can be very productive. And there are hedgerows, not quite the sort of network of fields that we get in Britain, but here we have more like rolling prairies, in fact, and maybe long shelter belts dividing them up, but they can be very productive. Yet another foxglove species. Sometimes as we're driving along, someone will shout out, an orchid growing on the bank. And it's nearly always these from a distance as you're whizzing along in the bus. They look a bit like that, but this, Lanata, I mean, sort of slightly woolly or downy, foxglove is a fairly common one. And similar in size to ours, can be maybe 2 meters tall. It's this beautiful yellow foxglove, another common roadside plant. We spend some time in little towns and villages, sometimes stopping for a coffee break. And it's quite good to do some busybodying, looking over garden walls or through gates. Very often we get invited in. The Bulgarians seem to be great gardeners, and in June, often they're really busy, the tomatoes growing like mad. It seems to be tomatoes and peppers particularly, but many fruit trees, lots of brassicas, chilies, quite popular. And every village boasts having stork colonies, and sometimes they try and outdo each other, putting up stork nesting platforms. Though common sound is the bill clapping of the storks, and a common sight on chimney pots, church towers maybe with the stork, would be the storks. Not so popular, the Colorado beetles. And the Bulgarians are always quite amused at how excited we get about seeing Colorado beetles. I'm afraid the gardeners, not that pleased about them, but it seems a very common and widespread species there. And they somehow or other, they do seem to cope. But even marigolds in someone's gardens can attract interesting butterflies, the brown argus in this case. We have lovely picnics, of course, wouldn't be a nature check trip without delicious local produce. And that time of year, fantastic cherries, wonderfully ripe tomatoes, and all these beautiful preserves. Well, a white wine here, marmalade even here, and honey, of course, there's jam. So we don't go hungry. We do have a lot of really local food. One of the famous sites that we visit is the Rila Monastery, an Orthodox Church monastery high up in the mountains. As you can see, pretty cloudy and wet up here. We have a long drive up some really interesting habitats to get to the Rila Monastery. And it still is a working monastery, which is a place of treated with great reverence and a site of pilgrimage for many Bulgarians. They're really keen on going here. So it's well worth a visit. It's a most spectacular place. And the pallid swifts, common swifts there, crag martins. We get dippers in the streams outside, grey wagtail, black redstart, nutcrackers in the forest. Don't really know where to look. And interesting plants that you might expect in a woodland area like this. Most of the monastery's residents come out to greet us when we're there. It's a place of, well, it's very spectacular, and really colourful. We ought to have a holy bramble, Rubus sancta. Sometimes this is called the elm-leaved bramble. At a glance, it is like any brambles that we get. But when you look closely, the leaves are rather different, a little more downy. So the second place we stay is this town of Bansko, which is further south from Sofia. And the town has a historic centre, beautiful old town, very well preserved. Now there are lovely avenues of lime trees, some of the old buildings, the church, of course, and many of the shops and old houses are preserved. And all around it are modern hotels, and we stay in one of them because it's an important ski resort. And in the summer, some of the lifts are open. We don't need to use them, but there's a fair amount of activity going on, and there are shops and coffee and all the usual things that you'd want, but a lovely, pleasant place to wander around. And the church tower has this amazing colony of swifts and storks in it. It's quite something to stand there and have the scent of lime trees all around you, and the stork's nest, the screaming of the swift. Spanish sparrows, of course, like to nest in stork nests. In quite a lot of places, there's stork cam, video cameras recording what's going on in the nest, because people are really keen on their storks. I mentioned the smell of lime trees, and one occasion looking up just to breathe in this beautiful scent of the lime blossom, was amazed at how many painted ladies were there, right in the center of Bansko. Back out in the countryside again, these rolling fields are just full of flowers, full of birdsong as well. And you will very soon start to hear the calls of quail. There'll be turtle doves calling from the cover, maybe a redback shrike somewhere, the tree sparrows, corn buntings, all the nice things that you might expect for an area like that. So you don't really know whether to look up or down. But of course, there are fantastic flowers in these meadows. Usually they don't belong to an individual, they perhaps belong to a village, and the entire village will come up when it's time to cut the hay or do whatever is necessary. So things like this beautiful cow wheat, common enough in the meadows, and often when we're walking along we will disturb insects, crickets and grasshoppers, and the small elephant hawk moth here. There'll be familiar plants, some orchids like green winged or a burnt tip orchid, plus things that we're not so familiar with. But whilst we're staying in Bansko, we head for the Pirin National Park. Beautiful area, very high mountains. In fact, the Bulgaria's highest mountain can be reached from the Pirin National Park. Now, this is June, midsummer, so there's still snow. Some years more than others. Sometimes the roads not quite blocked, but have to be passed with care. So dramatic place to visit. And all sorts of things to look for there. Thrivald's fragrant orchid, a very rare orchid, is one of the specialities of this area. Wet, flushy, is hopefully we'll find it alongside a path somewhere, not always out. More conspicuous is this geum, this Avens, this dazzling bright orange colour, a real splash of colour. We're naturally drawn to that. It's a bit harder to find those little orchids. The forests are made up as we go up the mountain slopes of the Bosnian pine, and then when we get beyond that zone, they're the dwarf mountain pine, but the Bosnian pine, these are magnificent trees. In fact, the oldest tree in Bulgaria is found a little bit further on. That's not it there, but it's thought to be 1,300 years old. So again, you never know whether to look up or down. Beautiful flowers, it's one flowered wintergreen. An interesting little fungi as well, a bird's nest fungus. You see the little spore capsules inside it. That's about the size of a 5p coin. So again, another typical Naturetrek scene. Here's Vladimir, our Bulgarian guide, pointing something out. And this orchid, looking a bit like our common spotted, isn't in fact. It's the wedge-lipped orchid, closely related. Of course, the butterflies, fascinating. You know, oh yes, a fritillary. And in fact, this one, Niobe fritillary, is not one we get in Britain. And this little honeywort, Cerinthe, related in fact to the golden drops. One that's a low-growing plant, quite often conveniently along roadsides. They're very proud of their national park, and always there are display boards telling you, often in English, German, and Bulgarian, of course, telling you what you might be able to see there, pointing out things like this endemic hardhead, this endemic knapweed, and this beautiful little Daphne, a beautifully scented Daphne, just one of several species. And the Alpine plants are very good, and we don't have to go all that far to get to them, but as we go up along stony trails and we leave the climbers, or the climbers leave us behind rather, they go roaring on, we spend our time looking around and all sorts of delights, really a sort of typical plants of those stony areas. Now we're away from the limestone here, so slightly different flora, but it can be very, very rich indeed. And of course, not just the plants, the ring ousels breed up there. You don't have to go to the Peak District or Wales to see them, we get those, and familiar birds like the bullfinch way up there, just on the forest edges up in the mountains, and chamois as well. And another species which is quite tricky to see generally, well, we get these in Hampshire, of course, in Britain, crossbills. Here, sometimes on a very, very steep slope, you find yourself on eye level with the treetops. So it's good to get views of the crossbills. So we're setting off on one of the typical trails, and it looks a bit crowded, but the group soon spread out and it's beautifully set out. None of the walking is that difficult. We stick to the trails generally, and all sorts of things are seen growing beside the trails, like this Balkan version of butterwort, this beautiful little greenweed, tiny little genista, about the size of a clenched fist. The boggy flushes are always worth exploring. This gentian, although it says Pyrenaica, was we're in the Balkan mountains, a great splash of colour, and the little gagia, a yellow Star of Bethlehem as well. Don't always need to go to those lengths, but high up here with an icy mountain tarn, and even up there when the snow has just melted, there are frogs. We often find frog spawn, so middle of June, the time they're spawning. And this lovely little bird's eye primrose, and the elder-flowered orchid as well. So there is colour and interest everywhere you look. Sit down for a breather, a bit of a lunch break, and here's the retreating snow, the winter snow. And that's always a profitable place to go and have a look, because these wonderful displays of crocus will appear. I think Boris was alluding to the crocus of hope appearing through the snow last week, wasn't he? Well, Crocus veliochensis does that very well. Sometimes carpets of them, it's impossible to walk because there are so many of these. And these lovely little alpine snowbells as well. But these are things of the edge of snow patches. So just to remind you, we started in Sofia. We had a look at a mountain here, then the Rila Mountains, and we've Pyrenean Mountains down here where we've just been. And we finally end up down here in the south, nearly in Greece, in the Rhodope Mountains. And the final place we stay, this one. This was created again in the communist era. And this was for the workers in the factories and in the cities who were all given 2 weeks holiday a year. This was built in the most stunning location. From the balconies, you can see the Rhodope Mountains and you're looking into Greece. And it's completely isolated. It's lovely and quiet. At night, you hear nightjars, maybe scops owls, maybe glowworms, and fabulous meadows and woodlands all around, and things like this violet limador or the yellow bird's nest growing just a little stroll down the drive of the hotel. The very famous Trigrad Gorge is nearby, and we go there for this plant. It looks like an African violet, but it is because it's related, the only member of this genus which grows in Europe. And it always grows at the wrong side of a waterfall, so it's quite safe, protected by the spray from the waterfall. And this is also a site for the wall creeper, a very well-known site. And again, you're looking across this horrendous drop to get to see the wall creeper. And my favorite is this beautiful bellflower, Campanula lingulata. So wonderful rich meadows, full of orchids, and sometimes we're lucky enough to find a hybrid. So green-winged on the left, and bug orchid on the right. And this strange one, which as far as we know, hadn't yet been named properly, this hybrid between green winged and bug orchid. Just a few specimens of that. A Roman bridge that once divided Bulgaria from Turkey, where I'm standing to take the photograph was Turkey, the other side of Bulgaria. Now it's all Bulgaria with greater butterfly orchid. And after a rainstorm, these fantastic Balkan copper butterflies just drying themselves off before flying away in the sunshine. And so of course we have plenty of time to study things and take photographs, compare the differences between these two at a glance, similar orchids, Cordillera and Baumaniana, both in marshy places. But when we have time to have a proper look and see the important differences between them. So to sum up, fantastic flowers everywhere, and very, very rich indeed, and even the most unlikely places, a building plot in the middle of a city, a roadside stop somewhere, motorway service station, you find these fantastic things, extremely rich. Viper's bugloss with a forester moth and this little flower beetle feeding on a hardhead flower. So plenty of interest, of course, long summer days, really friendly people. So I can certainly recommend a midsummer trip to Bulgaria if you've not been there. Thank you very much. Sorry to run over my time a little bit.
Thank you very much, Andrew. That's no problem. Fantastic talk and lovely images, just some stunning scenery that you've shared with us there. Thank you. to go to a short break now, just 5 minutes, and we'll be back at 25 past eight. So you've got time to pop to the loo, pop the kettle on, or top up your water, and we'll be back in 5 minutes' time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Right, everybody, welcome back. It's now my pleasure to hand you over to who will be taking you to the Vercors. Over to you, Paul.
Thank you. That one. And come on, I need to share my screen. Hello, what did I do?
You just need to click the green share screen button, Paul.
That's what I did do. Not going anywhere.
Oh, no, it's working. Just give it a second. Yeah, there we go. And then if you just make your presentation full screen.
That's what I just did once. Try again. Oh, there we go. Okay. Brilliant. Good evening, everybody. My name's Paul Harms. I've been working with Naturetrek since 1998, much the same time as our dear office manager started at a similar sort of time that I did. And I'm into my 20-somethingth year now. I don't care to remember how long. My main job in life was I was an electrical engineer with CEGB and National Grid Company. And I left that organisation and started my own company back in 2003. A part of which I was doing is working with Naturetrek. Well, today I'm going to take you down into the pre-Alps, to the west of the Alps, across the Isère River at Grenoble, to a place called the Vercors region of France. If you've ever looked it up on the internet, you will find the Vercors region as either a location for German orchid sites. The Germans are very, very fond of their European orchids. They like the Gargano and they like other parts of Europe as well. And the Vercors is a very famous orchid spot. It's based here to the southwest of Grenoble, where you can see La Chapelle and Vercors, which is our base. And it is a plateau that is high above the Isère River, which runs north up the road on the east side of the plateau, across the top of Grenoble and down to the southwest. As I said, it's a plateau that is high up here. The other thing you will have found if you've looked on the internet is that the Vercors has a very sad history, very tragic history in the Second World War with the resistance movement there. However, we shall move on. The Vercors, as I say, is a very, very peaceful, quiet, secret type location. When Andy and I first went there in 2003, it was very quiet and very very peaceful, and there were huge numbers of visitors, and it is not dissimilar now. Quite often, if you're there on a bank holiday, there will be German and Belgian motorcyclists passing through, heading south, but they don't seem to stay over. Occasionally, people are on campsites and things there, but it is relatively quiet and lots of lovely things to see. Whilst we are on the tours, there are four tours a year to this region. I will explain more about them at the end, but we do two in the spring and two in the summer. The two in the spring and the first summer one are general trips, which cover all things that we see, and the final one in the summer is a butterfly and moth trip, which I will explain a little more about later. This is La Chapelle en Vercors, which is where our base is. For the whole of the time we are here, we're just in the single location, and we travel out on each day to different parts of the region. The Vercors is a regional park, not a national park. And while we're here, we stay at the Hotel Bellier, and we've always stayed here. We are very well thought of, and we are very well looked after by Fabienne Bellier and her three daughters, who manage the site. They also are exceptionally good at catering for people with dietary requirements, which some people I've heard mention is a difficult thing to find in France. But we are very fortunate in that respect. We begin in our days out with a visit to some subalpine, which is mainly what the terrain is in this part of the world, subalpine meadows. This is summer grazing and winter skiing. As you can see, there's part of a ski slope across the middle of the track there. And the group is, we've parked up down below at the buildings and we're slowly walking up towards a headland at the far end. My colleague at the front there, just at the bottom of the hill, Alan Miller, is setting up a telescope to look at alpine marmots, which are very often heard whistling and watching us and sometimes come very close to us while we're here. But principally, it's a great place to start from a botanical perspective. There are a lot of lovely things to see here, not to mention the dogtooth violet, which is Erythronium dens carnis, and growing in amongst it, below it, is Crocus vernus, subspecies albiflorus. And going back to something Andrew mentioned in his talk, when we're here in early May, there are sometimes large snow patches with enormous populations of these crocuses and scillas around the snow patches as they recede, and also with the wonderful dogtooth violets coming out at the same time. Yellow whitlow grass, we have a single site in the UK that's well known to most people in southern Wales. But this is very common here on the limestone outcrops, great patches of yellow early spring flowers. Alpine snowbell, again, occasionally we get it on the edge of snow patches, but there are one or two locations where it seems to be, it prefers it when the snow is actually gone, it would appear. There's also things like Miserion, which is another species that is liking this limestone underlying strata. Elderflowered orchid here in its two colour forms, a very good place at the Font d'Erle to be able to see this particular species. It is very common across the whole of the Vercors Plateau. In this high summer, we get the French form of the black vanilla orchid. This one's Gymnodenia nigra, but it's also, Austriaca now, not nigra. Gymnodenia austriaca var gallica. There's quite a lot of it there in some numbers. In the spring and in the high summer, we get Adonis blue. In our country, we get just two broods. It's polyvoltine across Europe. In other words, it continues right the way through the summer with more than one brood, more than two broods. Excuse me. Sooty coppers, there's quite a lot of those in this part of the world in the spring. We always see plenty of those. When I mentioned the Vercors earlier, I said that the German orchid sites, websites are often mentioned. Well, one of the places that is well known is the Col de Bacchus. This region, which is about 6 to 10 square miles of limestone, has something approaching 48 species of orchid across the season. We obviously don't see all of them, but we do see an awful lot of them. Throughout a spring trip to the Vercors, we usually see in excess of 30 species and sometimes as many as 38 species and hybrids. One of the main ones we come to see is the drome orchid, this delightful little little plant similar to our bee orchids, which is much longer and bent labellum. Used to be Ophrys dromana, but now they've decided to call it Ophrys times flavicans, which seems to be a good cop-out for something they're not sure about its heritage. But the drome orchid is quite sufficient for what we see, and there's quite a bit of it here. It is very restricted and just restricted to Le Drome in this part of France. Lesser butterfly orchid, lots of that about in this region at that time in the spring, and also fly orchids. We do also get several hybrids. We've had a hybrid between the fly and the drome, And we've also had a hybrid between the fly and the early spider, which is quite a strange thing to see. Early spiders are quite often almost over by the time we reach there in early May. So they can be quite difficult to see. Bird's nest orchids, there's quite a few of those about. The pine woods are very good for those, and it does extremely well. And there can be big clumps of it with up to 10 spikes at a time. Monkey orchid, we've got a couple of sites in the UK in Kent and Oxfordshire, but in Southern Europe, there's quite a lot of it scattered about. And here is no exception. It is a very common orchid down in this part of the world, Orchis simia. And burnt orchid, which is Neotinia ustulata, again in good clumps, and came the occasional solitary ones, but they're usually quite good clumps and really quite showy. Excuse me. My personal favourite at this time of the year is a very robust species, just a bit smaller than a lady orchid, and this is Orchis palens, or the pale orchid. Absolutely plain yellow florets, no marks on the labellum at all, and these wonderful shiny green leaves, really very, very attractive. And we're fortunate enough to know several locations for this. So normally, and at slightly differing altitudes. So if it's over at some, it's possibly still coming at others. So we hopefully can usually get a reasonably good view of this particular species. Late spider orchid. This thing has gone through an awful lot of changes of name in the Vercors since I've been going there. It's had all sorts of names, and it's now finally been sunk without loss into late spider orchid, Ophrys fusiflora, and quite rightly so. It looks just like the ones from Kent, so I couldn't quite make it out as to anything else in the past, but others obviously knew better than I did. Moving up into the more mountainous bits, or the hilly bits, there's some quite precipitous roads in this part of the world. This is the root prel. This is very good for some of the bird watching that we do. Again, here we have arms folded, my colleague Alan Miller. The group here is on a very quiet lane looking at house martins nesting on cliff ledges where they really should nest. People enjoy what they're seeing. It's very good here for alpine swift, for kestrels, and for black kite and short-toed eagles. We get quite a few of all of those here. And also, we have been known to see these little fellas, war creepers. I guess we see war creeper when we first went to the Vercors back at when Andy and I went in the early 2000s. We could see these virtually every time we went. Nowadays, it's much harder. The local guides tell us that it's much easier to see them in the winters when they come down from the mountains and live in church towers. But there are occasions, we know places to look, and sometimes we're very fortunate and we get to see them. Perhaps one in three tours we get to see them these days. They're much, much harder. One of the advantages with visiting a place over such a long period of time is that you can see changes. And one of the changes also was there are two particular interesting owls in these regions, both incomers. There is the Tengman's owl and there is pygmy owl. And we used to be able to see them fairly easily if we went out at night with a local guide. But nowadays the birds have brought their nesting period forward and are now completely quiet by the time we get there in May and are concentrating on bringing up their families and are not calling territorial boundaries at all. So as I said, these things have altered over the period of time that we've been visiting this part of the world. In the lower parts, we get down to about 400 feet most of the time. I think La Chapelle is 1,200 feet above sea level. And we get down to 400 feet where we get things like woodlark, redback shrike and other passerine members from this sort, and slightly different plants. There's also quite a few short-toed eagles in this part of the world. Usually see those quite regularly. Griffon vulture. There's been a breeding project in the Vercors since about 1965, and they're doing very, very well. They're very well looked after. There are about a dozen feeding sites that they get, that the farmers, if they have dead animals, ring a telephone number and they're told which particular place to take them to, and the vultures have to go find it. But they're doing quite well. They seem to move their residence a bit. They've moved around three or four times to where they roost since I've been going there. But we still manage to find them, and we quite often see them, especially like at the Font d'Erle and places like that, the higher places where they're up in the sky. Locally, they've also reintroduced lammergeier or bearded vulture, whichever you prefer. I can't quite bring myself to call it a bearded vulture, but I will probably get used to it. Back in 2012, we were having a picnic one day when one of the group called to Alan to say, "What's that flying along the ridge?" There was a male lammergeier just drifting up the ridge from Plander Bay up in a northerly direction. I immediately rang a friend of mine who lives in that region and said to him, "When are you doing the lammergeier release?" Because I knew they were going to release some over on the east side in the Cirque d'Arcienne. And he said, "This coming weekend." I said, "Well, there's a male lammergeier coming in your direction," because he lived to the north of where we were. And he actually went out of his house to a particular spot and saw it go by. So it was quite pleasing to have one that wasn't introduced. But Laura Benito, one of our colleagues, found the introduced ones when we went to the Cirque d'Arcienne once. There was two males and a female were released up there, and they're still there. The Hope Plateaus, there are plateaus upon the plateau. And this is just below Le Grand Vaimont, which is the highest mountain in the region. And the Hope Plateau is a site for an isolated population of black grouse. This photograph was taken by Laura. And here, at the time of the year we get there, it's the young males that are still trying to pair off that are lekking. All the older males and females have all paired off and gone away, but the young males are still calling. And they lek from the top of a tree. One or two of them hop up and down on the ground, as we would expect in the UK, but these guys call from the top of a tree. As you get up there, early morning, we go up there very early, just before light, and you can hear the bubbling calls of the males as you're approaching. It's about a 2.5 kilometer walk from the car park to the actual lek site in the dark, unfortunately, but it's good fun. And Alan's had some very successful, and Laura have had some very successful times up there. The lady slipper orchid is always a popular orchid with botanists, and the Vercors is no exception. The unfortunate thing is that two of the scarcest orchids in this part of the world to see are quite away from our base, but it's well worth the visit. The meadows up high, the subalpine meadows, are very, very good for butterflies and very, very good for other insects as well, where these lady slipper orchids grow. And this little chap, Spitzel's orchid. If someone was to tell you there was an orchid that's got green sepals with pink dots inside, you'd think they'd been on the beer or something. But this is certainly what it has got. Two populations of this in Europe, one in the south, and then another isolated population up at Åland in Sweden. And they once upon a time thought they were a bit different, but I don't think they are. However, I'm not a taxonomist. So there is usually a good chance of seeing this species in on the spring trips, and it is quite restricted. I don't know anywhere else it grows in that area. I'm sure some of my colleagues may know it, but certainly not me. But this is certainly one of the best ones to see while we're there. This little fella is almost impossible to see in the UK now. The last time it flowered in the UK was in 2011 in Herefordshire. But we do see quite a number of them on our summer trip, the summer general trip. This is one of the highlight species. We used to also be able to see summer ladies' tresses, but sadly, the site it was on got very badly burnt by a bushfire. And unfortunately, it doesn't seem to have survived, but there we are. There are quite a few nice shady pine woods, which have got some good colonies of these. I mean, it has its bad years and it has its good years, but yeah, we quite often see these. I think I've only failed on one occasion to find them. So the summer trip is where we see ghost orchids. Onto the butterfly side, our summer trip for butterflies and moths. We are based at the same hotel and we do keep a permanent moth trap at that hotel. In the spring trips, if it's warmer, because I said we were up at 1200 feet, if we get warmer mornings first thing or warmer nights, I will put the moth trap out occasionally as an alternative to morning birding just to see what we can find. When we're butterflying, some of the species we see both in the spring and the summer, we sometimes get checkered skipper, quite restricted with us now in the UK, unless you live up around Oban. Knapweed fritillary, very common in this part of the world. One of the unusual fritillaries like the one Andrew was showing you. We get batten blue in the spring. We do very well for these. They're quite readily flying when we're in there in May. Clouded Apollo. On a couple of occasions, we've come across the morning that these have hatched, when there's been a mass hatching, when you've seen 200 or 300 of these sort of drying wings and just flying and just basking. And mating, but fabulous butterfly, the clouded Apollo. The ordinary Apollo, lots and lots of these in the summer, and if we get it warm in the spring, we get them as well, which is quite a very large and very showy butterfly. Again, black vein white, which Andrew mentioned earlier, used to last was seen in Kent a long, long time ago, but on the continent, lots of those. And this was a very interesting find back in the year before last, 2018, was mountain alcon blue. And we know it's mountain alcon blue because she is egg laying on the food plant, which is the cross gentian, Gentiana cruciata. The first time I managed this one was with Alan Miller when we were doing a butterfly trip in Italy. And he sent me a photograph of the plant saying, "What's this plant?" And when I said cross gentian, he said, "Thank you, you've proved it was alcon, mountain alcon blue." So that's how I've learned how to do that myself. So a lovely, very ordinary looking butterfly, very similar to a lot of others, but female egg laying on the flowers of the cross gentian. Revardin's blue. It's one of the silver studded group, as you can just make out on the lower wing at the back, the little blue studs in the black markings, but very strong orange on the upper and lower wing. Revardin's blue is uncommon, but we do see them. I know a couple of places where if you're going to see them, that's where to go. But I don't come across them by accident very often. As I said, we'll do a moth trap. This one is a July high flyer and was actually seen in July, although I have seen them in May in this part of the world as well. Scarce silver lines. Again, I have seen it in Britain, but not very often. It's not uncommon on the continent. Small elephant hawk moths. We've also had spurge hawk. We've had privet hawks, and we've had eye hawk moths in the trap. We also get leopard, which is less common in the British Isles. And the place we put the moth trap is by the wall of a 12th century chapel, which has got a lot of indentations in the wall. And one morning we were out with the trap for about an hour and a half, and I was packing it away, and I suddenly looked up and noticed that there was a goat moth sitting on the wall and had been there the entire time we'd been doing the trap, and nobody had seen it. It was quite a nice little surprise, well, quite a large surprise. No Naturetrek trip is complete without a picnic. One of the advantages with the Vercors is there's a lot of farming goes on, so there's lots of milk and cheese and butter that all comes from that part of the world. The hotel only buys organic and local produce. The wine here also comes from near where the lady's slipper orchids grow. So the whole area, the food and wine is exceptionally good. And our hotel now even is supplies us with local beer that is made on the plateau as well. Okay, as I said to you at the beginning of the evening, of my part of the evening, we do four trips to the Vercors. In the spring, we go by train. The first May trip, we go down on a Sunday from St. Pancras to Lille, Europe, and then on down to Lyon Part Deux, where we take our minibuses and drive down. It's about a two-hour drive from Lyon down to where we stay in the Vercors. And then the second week in the spring, people can come by air should they choose to do so. The summer July trip is also by air, as is the butterfly and moth trip in July, which follows straight on after the summer. Some people have done both the summer and the butterfly and moth trip together. However, I should point out that it's not impossible to reach the Vercors by train if flying is something you prefer to do less of. If you can get down to Lyon Part Deux, there is now a tram between the railway station and Lyon Saint-Exupéry Airport. It takes about 35 minutes. I can't remember how much it costs, but it is possible to get a train down. There is also a TGV station at the airport, but if you're going to go to that, you have to go via Paris, and some people prefer not to. So it is quite easy to get there by train if you would prefer not to fly. But in principle, the three later trips all go by air. Thank you for watching. I hope you had a little bit of a taster from where we've been. And just thanks to these guys for providing the photographs. And I'll pass you back to Sarah.
Thank you very much, Paul. Fantastic talk. Now, David, over to you, where you're going to take us to the Tien Shan Mountains in Kazakhstan.
Can you see that?
Yep, that's perfect.
Cool. Right. So yeah, thanks everyone. I'm David Morris. I've been working for Naturetrek for 14 years, I think, this year. Work for the RSPB normally, my passion is mountainous and cold places in the world, both in terms of birds and the plant butterfly life. So general natural historian, with a passion for alpine flora. Kazakhstan, not many people have thought of going botanizing there. It's an interesting place to go, and Naturetrek run a small handful of trips to Kazakhstan, both birding trips and a number of botanical trips. When you talk to people about Kazakhstan, they don't know a huge amount of about the country. The thing that normally comes to mind is the cult film of the noughties, and you'll be pleased to know that the country is absolutely nothing like the film. It really is a fantastic country, a vast place. It's the ninth largest country in the world and has one of the lowest population densities of any country in the world as well. And with all that open space, there's some fantastic wildlife. Most of Kazakhstan is a kind of big areas of kind of flat plateau and steppe, but in the west of the country, rising dramatically from the plains and steppe are the Tien Shan mountains that border the sort of Chinese, Kyrgyzstan and Uzbekistan border. It's a, as I say, a relatively large country in Central Asia, that kind of one of the latest countries really to split from the Soviet Union in the early 90s. And since then has become a rather modern independent country. But yeah, with vast natural history wealth. Our trip here that I'm kind of going through is our alpine flowers of the Tien Shan. It tends to go in around middle of June, which is sort of just good timing to get the bulk of some of the most interesting alpine plants, and also get some of the tail end of things like some of the tulips and stuff as well, which an earlier tour does go specifically to see, but this gives you a really good mix of flora, as well as some really interesting bird life and butterflies and some quite exciting mammals thrown in for the mix. And for a botanist, it's a really interesting area because it's on the kind of Silk Road through that part of Central Asia. And it's also the sort of meeting place between the sort of European flora and the sort of Chinese Asian flora in the West. Also home to particularly some of the kind of bulbous flora, which I personally find really interesting and exciting plants. And many plants as well that I think people in the UK will be very, very, very familiar with, particularly in a kind of horticulture and gardening context as well. Some really fascinating garden-worthy plants that you see growing in profusion as wild plants, and things like tulip and that obviously originated out in places like Kazakhstan before being collected by the Dutch. The trip we do is a two-centre trip. The first part of the trip we spend around Il Alatau National Park, which is just south of Almaty. Fly to Almaty via Istanbul, and then the second part of the trip we take a sleeper train west through the country along the foothills of the Tien Shan over towards Aksuzabagli, which is Central Asia's oldest nature reserve, down smack bang on the Uzbek border towards Tashkent. The Il Alatau area, just a stone's throw out of Almaty, and as soon as you get off the plane, you can see the Tien Shan rising above you. You can see a small red dot just in the top of the presentation there. That's roughly where our accommodation is, in just starting to creep up onto the edge of the tree line. And the main areas that we visit on this part of the trip is the area around sort of Big Almaty Lake, which is about 2,500 meters, the Zulzakizan Pass, an old Soviet sort of cosmos station, which is about 3,336 meters. And then we push it up towards Big Almaty Peak, which is at the sort of 3,681 metres in altitude. This is our accommodation on the first leg of that trip. I always think it's a bit like Switzerland meets Tibet. Really interesting accommodation, nestled in these pencil pine woodlands, overlooking some of the peaks. Quite modern European standards there. Great food, good accommodation, and allows us to sort of really get to grips with some of the kind of local wildlife in a really easy way. Some fantastic walks straight out of the room, plenty of wildlife, some really great bird life, things like blue whistling thrush. There's a kind of subspecies of red squirrel around there, and then some fantastic flora, as you can see, kind of meadows on tap within a short walk. And a walk around some of the pencil pine woodland around there, start to find some of the kind of classic plants to introduce yourself to that region. So two particularly interesting primulas, Primula kaufmanniana and Matholii, and brotheri subspecies, two woodland-dwelling primulas that are found in amongst the kind of rocky areas, amongst the pines there. And some really great birds as well. This is Sertovs or white-browed tit warbler, much desired species, but hangs around the accommodation, really confiding. One of the defining features about this part of the world as well is apples, and Kazakhstan is the sort of natal home of apples. The species on the right, Malus seversii, is what's thought of the parent of the domestic apple, as well as some other really interesting apple species that make up the scrub component there, including Nadzwitskiana, which is this small sort of claret red crab apple with these amazing, intense, bright pink pips. For those more familiar with kind of European trips, there's a huge amount of similarities to trips to, say, the Alps, the Pyrenees, places like that, in terms of the plant communities, albeit slightly different species or different families of plants. So this is one of our clients on the trip enjoying some of the meadows around the accommodation, this fantastic claret red aquilegia, and then a range of other sort of Asiatic plants starting to creep in, like some big leafy cabbage-like ligularias in the foreground. Codenopsis, fantastic campanula relative. Again, a plant people recognise from the garden often, but grows in profusion in the sort of shady screes around the edge of the meadows. And then we take time to acclimatise, because although we're only 3,600 metres, gradually getting up in the altitudinal zone. This is above Big Almaty Lake, fantastic plants like Ligularia macrophylla, and on those kind of braided streams at the back of Big Almaty Lake is breeding ground for ibis bill as well, which we see really well. I think being a botanical trip primarily, you get the time to explore the bird life much more detail as well, and you've got stuff like Himalayan ruby throat in amongst the scrub in that area. Great transport infrastructure in this area with metalled roads all the way up to the pass, and a good opportunity to sort of stretch the legs from the road, various car parks to look for the plants. So we start creeping up into the alpine zone there, start seeing some plants that although look very similar to our bird's eye primrose. This is Primula algida, a small farinosed primula that studs the turf there, along with things like Gentiana prostrata. And then thinking about gentians, you're often driving up the road here and see this sort of royal blue, which you would automatically think is a kind of Gentiana recallis or something like that. It's actually this fantastic dragon's mouth, the sort of Dracocephalum grandiflorum, which grows in sheets of amazing blue. Up on the Zulzakizan Pass, about 3,300 metres here we are, you can see the road in the bottom there, and you've got patches of snow melt in there, exposing some of those very early flowering plants. The buttercups are particularly outstanding in that part of the world. This is Ranunculus kamchaticus, rather interesting early buttercup, growing there in front of the old Soviet cosmos station. But I think one of the plants of the trip for me is this delightful little trolleus, Trolleus lillocinus, which has got these double pleated sort of icy blue flowers, and it flowers just before the leaves start to come as the snow's melting around it, like a crocus would in Europe. Some of the really good quality plants in that area as well, things like Calianthemum alatavicum, a endemic Viola alteica, which has a blue and a cream yellow form, and the tiny, tiny little endemic Viola Tien shanica, which also grows in the turf there. But I think one of the stars of that part of the area is our first tulip of the trip. This is Tulipa heterophylla, only grows to about 2 inches, and this bonny little tulip with sort of nodding yellow flowers, you can see there growing in amongst the violas. Bit further up the slopes, you start to get another tulip species. This is Tulipa dagestemon. This grows in the more free-draining screes. Slightly higher up at altitude, this is getting up to sort of 3,500 metres. But plant of the trip for me and sort of many of the clients on the trip is delightful Paraquilegia nemenoides, which we searched out north-facing pockets with snow still clung in there. And this plant crawls in amongst the crevices, amongst the rocks. And flowers with fantastic profusion. onto the second part of the trip, and yeah, no nature trek trip is complete often without a bit of train spotting. Well, in this case, you spend the best part of 24 hours on this train, and this is the sleeper train that takes you from Almaty down, going towards Tashkent on the Uzbek border. Comfortable sleeper arrangement. And it parallels the Tien Shan Mountains with a fantastic train ride, and you get some sleep on there, wake up refreshed. At our second location near Zabagli. This is the Aksu Zabagli Nature Reserve area. Just to the south of here is the Uzbek border, and big areas of permanent glaciers there, which is the home to things like snow leopard, which unfortunately we didn't see, but just to know they might have seen us was good enough. Two bits of accommodation we stay at there. We stay in Zabagli village down on the bottom on the edge of the plains. And we also spent a couple of nights up at a mountain research hut as well, right in the foothills. Start off down on the Coxai Canyon, lower down in altitude, just in the foothills, and then make our way up to the Aksu Gorge. The Aksu is the white river that brings the glacial snowmelt water out down the valley, and then stay up in the Ulkhankeindy Valley before going up to the Ulkhankeindy Pass. Difference here is the infrastructure is not as well developed, so it's more kind of four-wheel drive vehicles and some horse riding for those that fancy it. Down in the Coxai Canyon, fantastic conglomerate valley, looks like it should be an Indiana Jones theme set, and some of those fantastic geophytes. This is foxtail lilies, Eremurus tienshanicus, one of about five species of foxtail lilies that we find growing in there. And anyone who likes their onions will be pleased with this place, with a good range of alliums on show of all colours, including some species that many people, again, on the trip were very familiar, having grown them in their garden, things like Allium caritaviense down on the bottom left. Nice to see the locals out. So yeah, this was a chap out, a traditional Kazakh horseman, absolutely made up, asking us for a pose for a photo. And he was out there grazing what looked like Holstein Friesians on the edge of the steppe. We then get in our four-wheel drives and start making up through these kind of lush meadow areas, through the foothills, gaining altitude steadily. Again, fantastic range of plants, delphinium confusum, big royal blue delphiniums. And yet again, a few more tulips for good measure. This is Tulip egregii, has both red and the yellow colour forms, and saw this in both flowering and in seed. Not as much profusion as an early tulip trip, but you get some really good quality plants around it that are flowering that bit later in the season. They're the foothills of the Ulkhankeindy Valley. You can just make out in the middle the Ulkhankeindy Mountain Hut, which is where we stay for a couple of nights, three nights I think that was, in which to explore this fantastic landscape. Straight out of your accommodation, up into these valleys, you've got more onions. This is Allium carolinianum, and a range of kind of bed straws and dictamnus and things growing up on the slopes. Good range of butterflies. And this is Apollo, the species, same species we get in Europe, but loving these glades, absolutely full of butterflies and insect life. Again, anyone who likes their bulbs, this is Fritillaria stenanthera, fantastic early pink snowmelt flowering fritillary. And the species I was really keen to see, this is Iris wilmottiana, part of the Juno section of the iris family that flowers in profusion under the fennel covered slopes in the background. Birds aren't too bad either up here, rock thrush, and also some of the best views ever I've had of Himalayan snowcock when on horseback, where you don't disturb them as much. And yeah, second paraquilegia species, this is cespitosa that grows in that particular valley, and also Primula minwixiae, very rarely seen plant. So a lady in America who runs a Primula World, a website with Primula, documented Primula all over the world, and she hadn't even got a photo of this Primula, and we were lucky to find several clumps of this stunning plant on the rocks at the top of the valley there. As I say, horse riding for those who fancy it, to get up from the Ulkhankeindy Pass down in the bottom, up onto the top, really enjoyable, nice ploddy old nags that take you up there, some great plants on the way. You're riding your horse up through sort of meadows full of things like anemone narcissiflora, and again, another fantastic trolleus. This is Trolleus altacus, and you can see there the steps below in the distance. You get off your horse, let that wander around to munch some of the native flora, and you can see again the snows are clearing, and yet again the profusion of colour and sheets here of Tulipa kaufmanniana, the water lily tulip, growing, as I say, like crocus would in Europe. Poke about amongst them some other species. This is Dagistemonoides, including a rather interesting double form that we found. And some more stunning iris. This is Iris kapalskiana, which is a member of the reticular iris family, which, yet again, loves the snowmelt conditions. And some classic higher altitude alpines. This is Androsaceae sericea, some of these cushion-forming high altitude alpines that form on these ridges. Again, I've not got the picture of the picnic, but this is a classic Naturetrek picnic location, looking across onto the cap glaciers at the other end, looking for things like snow leopard and Tien Shan brown bear up at nearly 3,000 metres. We then, for the final couple of days before going home, we drop down into the Aksu Gorge, this fantastic canyon with the white glacial meltwater river at the bottom. A much more Mediterranean climate here with some interesting plants, including several endemics. This is Sergia cerozoei, a campanula relative, and an interesting goosefoot relative, Raphifidon regalii. These are red data book species for Kazakhstan. But interesting to see some very rare plants that you wouldn't see anywhere else on Earth. And yeah, a plant that many plant breeders have used to develop the kind of roses that people see in their gardens nowadays with this two-tone colour. This is Rosa persica, fantastic, lovely scented rose that lives in the arid steppe conditions there. And I think I'll leave you with a absolute sunset there of Trolleus altacus. Yet again, a take-home memory for me and many of the clients on that trip.
David,
cool.
That was a fantastic presentation. Just some lovely photographs there, the tulips and the roses are brilliant. Okay, we now have some time to go to questions. And I will just allow some of the other panelists to unmute, just so we can get Paul. There we go, brilliant. Right, okay, I'll pull up our questions. So firstly, Jessica, I have a question for you. What will the wildlife highlights be at Christmas on Gran Canaria?
Okay, so I've actually typed an answer to that and sent it off. They're basically the same as in the spring and autumn. So there'll be the chance for the Gran Canaria blue chaffinch. There's African blue tit. You've got... other endemic birds around. You've got obviously plenty of canaries, that sort of thing. Quite a few of the butterflies fly all year, the monarch, the canary red admiral should get to see. Not quite so many things in flower, but there are some winter flowering things around, depending a little bit on just how much rain they have in the winter. So yeah, there's still plenty to see in the Christmas trip, and the fact that it's Christmas may mean small changes to the itinerary, but probably nothing significant.
Great, thanks Jessica. Andy, a question for you. You're going to have to get your crystal ball out. When are we anticipating being able to start sending to
evening? Or, well, unsurprisingly, this is a question we've had on most of these presentation evenings, and it, as you say, Sarah, it is a case of gazing into the crystal ball. In a nutshell, day trips are off the ground under the rule of six from the 29th of March. All overseas trips and multi-night trips in the UK are cancelled up to and including the 16th of May. Potentially, things can start getting moving again on the 17th of May, but it does depend what the government tell us on the 12th of April. That's when Grant Shapps promises to give us all an update on where we stand with airport PCR testing, travel vaccine passports, and the opening up of corridors with trusted other countries. So we're all on tenterhooks with Sarah on that one at the moment, but we'll know much more, I hope, after the 12th of April.
Thanks, Andy. David, a question for you. I can see you're typing a response, but you're welcome to give the response verbally. It's a question from Tim Arnold. Two questions about temperature. Bulgaria in July, so that's one for Andy. And I think the other was about Kazakhstan. You may have just hit send on it. So yes, Kazakhstan also high up. So David, if you want to go first.
Yeah, so I've just posted the answer. So in around kind of June, it's typically around sort of 18 to 25 around the sort of accommodation areas on both locations. Once you start getting really high, particularly up around the kind of glacier snow line, it's 16 to 18, 20 sometimes. So not dissimilar to going on a kind of European trip into the Alps or something like that, really. Bit cooler at night, but yeah, much better than winter when it gets down to the sort of minus 30, 40 continental climate.
Thank you, David. And Andrew, the same question to you about Bulgaria in July in the mountains.
Actually, the Flowers of the Balkans is in June, in midsummer, and it'd be like midsummer here, really, pleasant summer days. It's not excessively hot. We're nice enough to sit outside in the evenings in some of the places we stay to have our meals. And what we do have to watch for just a very occasional thunderstorm, which can sometimes come very quickly in the mountains and then disappear again. So I would say maybe low to mid-20s would be about the highest temperature we've experienced, and never excessively cold, even high up in the mountains, because it is midsummer after all, long summer days.
Yeah. Paul, a question for you from Neil Pike. What's the chance of red helleborine on the summer Vercors trip?
Reasonable. It's unfortunate. It's an unfortunate species. We occasionally get it in the spring, if the season is advanced, and we can sometimes just miss it in the summer. But on both occasions, I have seen it on both trips. It's one of those that's a marginal, but it is possible. I know where to look.
And a question I'd like to put to the panelists actually is something that we do get asked. Occasionally, what level of expertise do you need to enjoy one of these holidays? You're obviously all experts in your field, but what about a guest who wouldn't consider themselves a botanist at all, and they have limited knowledge, but they are interested, but would say class themselves as a keen gardener?
A keen gardener may actually know more about some of the plants than I do. No expertise needed, just enthusiasm. And, we don't mind how often we tell people names of things, and you don't have to take any notice, even if we do tell you.
No, it's a second that. We often get people who are gardeners, or perhaps alpine gardeners, and they're fascinated to see things growing where they belong, but equally others who just like being in these places. And that's what we're there for, to help. And I enjoy doing it, telling people what things are. Sometimes, say, a tour leader is like a song thrush. You have to say everything three times. Repeat it, but don't mind doing that. Don't worry if you don't know.
Ditto. And I think that's why I particularly enjoy leading the sort of general natural history trips as much as I do the birding trips and things like that. It's just that slightly slower rate of pace, and people can take in a broader range of things and really geared around any interest or knowledge of kind of plants, inverts, birds, that sort of thing.
I've often made a joke out of trying to remember what the English name is of some of the plants. So that's one of the reasons I did my talk as I did, with English names on it, because I knew I could do the scientific names straight off, but I knew the English names would take a little while. But I'll get there in the end.
And the beauty is, in Kazakhstan, is there's very few plants that have any English names. So everyone's guessing sometimes on some of the names, particularly given
that. Like you did in your talk, you gave them something that it's like, or it's similar to, or it's in the family of tulips or the family of roses. That's fine. But a lot of people will be happy with that.
Great. Thanks, all. David, I have a couple of more Kazakhstan questions for you. Firstly, can Kazakhstan cope with food intolerance, no dairy and no eggs?
So the places we've stayed are pretty well equipped for Western diets. And certainly the first place, the kind of Switzerland versus Tibet place, I mean, that is no problems whatsoever. And then the second place we go to, yeah, again, the accommodation there is really good. But even when we go up to that mountain hut, we took a couple with us. The chap looked after the horses and his wife looked after the cooking. And she cooked everything from scratch. So it's so easy and simple to kind of cater for those dietary needs when you cook like that. So, yeah, I'd say it's so long as people declare it when booking, it can be kind of thought about in advance and done. So, yeah, I don't think... And you don't really eat lots of weird... A lot of people thought, oh, Kazakhstan, you're going to eat really bizarre food, and that's not the case.
Thanks, David. And similarly on the Kazakhstan trip, what level of fitness is for that trip?
So I would have said, beyond the horse riding, it's not much dissimilar to doing a European trip in the mountains. So you'd need a reasonable degree of fitness, but it's kind of as much as you want, because particularly the first section, you drive, park, walk, and it's the same with the second bit. You can kind of walk as little or as far as you want, really. I mean, it is a grade A, I think it is. So it is, you are walking more than you are driving. And then in terms of the horse riding stuff, I mean, most of the clients that I took with me had never been on a horse before. And although it looks impressive riding horses in the mountains like that, and absolutely experience out of your life, very little riding experience is needed, because those horses, despite looking like thoroughbreds, are really good ploddy horses that are capable with people of all abilities. So, yeah, I think it's the altitude thing, but yet again, it could impact me, it could impact some of the youngest people on the trip. You just take it steady, acclimatise and get going. And so, yeah.
Thanks, David. We have a question here from Janet Chart. She says she likes that we included the monastery in Bulgaria, and for people who have been having a bit of culture mixed in with their tours as well as wildlife, do we do many trips that mix both? Andy, maybe you're best positioned to answer that question.
I think all the leaders speaking tonight would agree that we're trying not to ignore any aspect of local interest and history on our trips. Some trips have more cultural and historical input than others, but I can read off several trips that have quite a lot of local historical content. The Cathar Carcassonne trip in France, for example, lots of our long haul trips to places like Cambodia and Belize, Tikal, Machu Picchu in Peru. Those were long haul tours, but within Europe, I think most tours have at least one example of a visit to an interesting local church or monument and some historical input. So, yeah, the best thing to do is contact us, I think. If you'd like to go on holiday and kind of mix wildlife interest with local history and culture, pick up the phone and have a chat with us, and we'll point you in the right direction.
I would second that. We did also do an article last year about the best holidays for combining wildlife and culture. So I can find the link to that and pop that into the chat in the next couple of minutes. Alternatively, you just googled it and hopped onto our website, you'd find it there. I think we've actually all of our questions for this evening. I don't see any outstanding ones, so I just can't see any more. So for now, I think we'll end there. I'd like to give a huge thank you to our presenters for joining tonight, and to all of you at home for tuning in and listening. The 19th presentation evening we've done so far. If you've missed any, don't worry, then you can actually watch them online. If you just hop onto our homepage, there's a link to our roadshow there, and if you just scroll down to the bottom of the webpage, you can watch them all at leisure. If you'd like to give us any feedback, please do. It's always very welcome. Email us at info@naturetrek.co.uk. Finally, if you're a member of a natural history club or society and you'd like a Naturetrek speaker to deliver presentation to your members free of charge, then we'd be very happy to do so. Please just contact us to arrange it. We'll be back the same time on Wednesday evening next week, so the 17th of March at 7:30. We'll be talking about wildlife cruises, taking you to Baja California, Kamchatka, India and Brazil. So we hope you can join us. We'll stay online for the next 5 minutes or so, just in case anyone has any last minute questions, and I'll pop a couple of links into the chat, which I've just referred to. But until the next time, take care, everyone, and good night. Thank you.
Bye.